Okay, and here we are. We have now gotten to the end, so far as we know, of the Rat catalog with 2010's Infestation. The album was released April 20th, 2010. 420. I wonder if there was a reason for that. The album was produced by Michael Elvis Basquiat, who has also worked with bands like Limp Bizkit, Puddle of Mudd, Seven Dust, Alter Bridge, and several other nu metal, metalcore, and alternative rock bands, whatever you want to call them, and who more recently actually produced Wolfgang Van Halen's very well-received debut, the Mammoth WVH album in 2021. So clearly, Michael is still out there working. Good for him. Infestation was released by Loud and Proud via Roadrunner Records, a then sub-label of Rat's longtime home, Atlantic Records. And the Infestation lineup included. Now, just in case anybody's not aware, this is actually Robbie Crane's third straight Rat album that he has played on instead of Juan Croucier. The singles from Infestation included Best of Me and Eat Me Up Alive. In the US, the album debuted at number 30, selling around 14,000 copies. I think they mean in the first week, making it Rat's highest charting album since 1990, 20 years earlier. The album has since gone on to sell over 50,000 copies in the US and an estimated 150,000 plus worldwide. Okay. First, what the hell has happened to you people? If you want your favorite bands to make new music, go buy some fucking media, for goodness sake. And second, that's about 50,000 less copies than the estimated 200,000 that were sold of the 99 album. Yikes. In Japan, Infestation charted at number 5. The album also reached number 49 in Finland, number 55 in Canada, number 78 in Switzerland, and number 139 in France. And probably like number 78,452 on Pluto, while barely charting at all on Neptune, I would guess. I don't know. As for the professional ratings, About.com gave Infestation 4 out of 5 stars. Allmusic gave Infestation 2.5 out of 5 stars. Blabbermouth.net, if you value anything they have to say, gave it 8 out of 10 stars, while BW and BK gave it 9 out of 10 stars. Exclaim gave it a favorable rating. Music OMH gave it 4 out of 5 stars. And Pop Matters gives Infestation 7 out of 10 stars. So, for the most part, some pretty good reviews on this album from those kind of sites, and a couple that weren't quite as great. Okay, so not a terrible cover. I do kind of like this color scheme. I'm not exactly sure what the point of all this was, though. What's the deal with these modern graphics, folks? Backward and upside down photos and words we can't possibly read. That's the thing in the new century, huh? Okay, if you say so. But please keep in mind, Old people are still alive and are really apparently the only ones actually still buying this shit. So you might want to think about that. All right. As for me, I was so excited when I heard this album was coming out, especially when I heard what the lineup was going to be. I'll go on record here right now and say that one of the best decisions Rat has probably ever made in their history was bringing Carlos Cavazo into the band at this point. They could have gone in so many other directions with that decision, but didn't, thankfully. Carlos was perfect for Rat at this point. Now, I'm not sure I really knew I felt that way to this extent when I first heard that news. I'd always liked Carlos. I was a fan of his playing to an extent in the Quiet Riot heyday. I'd seen them live. That was actually my first big concert, in fact, and I was quite impressed by him. And you can go on YouTube and find a bunch of those old Quiet Riot live videos and performances of the Mental Health songs and see that Carlos is a really solid live player for sure. But I don't think I actually appreciated what a great guy he seems to be until Rat fired Warren DeMartini. And Carlos immediately quit and basically became the first person on earth to say, "No Warren, no Rat," which I accept as a universal axiom. Carlos, if you ever happened upon this video, I'd love to personally thank you for being a real stand-up guy and constantly displaying a sense of integrity and doing what's right. Bless you. Anyway, it never would have occurred to me just how great a fit Carlos and Warren would be together, but I think they were. And as a guy who used to play guitar, I also want to say that hearing what Carlos's playing sounds like in 2010, he is a far more exciting player than he was in the 80s. It's too bad the guys in Rat couldn't pull their heads out of their asses and make things work because they had a real opportunity here to maybe, just maybe, build something again and do something pretty great a second time. Way past the point where they should have been able to expect that chance. But again, as usual, they found a way to blow it. Way to be consistent, guys. And that being said, it didn't start out that way, but over time, I have to admit to having really mixed feelings about this album. Firstly, I absolutely love the approach they took here. Putting together an album so loud and so heavy and so aggressive and so consistent. This is easily the heaviest album front to back in the entire Rat catalog. Second, as I already said, I love this lineup. I don't honestly know that you could have come up with a better lineup for this album at this time. I think from the music videos and the live clips of this lineup, you can clearly see that it worked. I also think a couple of these songs are among the very best things Rat has ever written and recorded throughout their history. And we'll get to that in a bit. But before we do, I apparently am not a big fan of producer Michael Elvis Basquiat because no matter how much I love what I think they were trying to do on Infestation, I am not a fan of this album's overall sound at all. And yes, I know. I'm old. I get it. I understand. Thanks for pointing it out. But I still love loud music, I promise. Loud, though, doesn't necessarily have to mean distorted and shitty sounding, does it? And I get it. The first time I heard this album, I was just so happy to have a heavy sounding Rat album in 2010 after so much time without them that I would have almost overlooked Juan's bass parts from the EP coming out my speakers again without even complaining. But holy crap! The first time I heard this CD in my car, I seriously thought something was wrong. I was absolutely sure I had a couple of blown speakers or something. And then I took the CD over to my friend's Metal Sean's house for Metal Night. Okay, Metal Night is basically Metal Sean and some of the rest of us guys he's friends with hanging out all night, talking, drinking beer, and jamming to everything from 80s pop metal to thrash and black metal and whatever else he decides to play. So anyway, Sean likes rap, so I thought he'll like this since it's possibly the heaviest album Rat has ever made. I'll take it over there and he'll thank me for sharing such awesomeness with him and pleasing the metal gods. And maybe, just maybe, if the metal gods like this as much as I think they're going to, we won't have to sacrifice any chickens tonight. And then he pops it in his stereo, which, keep in mind, has to be able to handle every terribly produced doom, black, and death metal album ever recorded. Not to mention a lot of those being shit that's released on independent labels with production that, in a lot of cases, is supposed to sound like the apocalypse. And make those sound good side by side with all the well-recorded and mass-produced albums from actual greedy, rich 80s record companies without Metal Sean having to stop every 35 minutes to adjust his EQ because, he's drunk. And when he finally puts Infestation on, within about 20 seconds, we're all staring at the stereo and thinking, what the hell is wrong with it? And then, of course, Kiss apparently heard it and decided they'd rip off the overall sound quality or lack thereof for their 2012 album Monster. Because, as I said in that review, that album could have been pretty great, but sounds like absolute distorted shit, too. So, anyway, when it comes to Infestation, like I said, mixed feelings. Meaning, there are things I loved about this album. Like when it first came out, I thought it was possibly the most consistent sequence of songs on a Rat album since Out of the Cellar. I initially thought they were all really well written, well played, well recorded, and all that stuff. Until I'd had a little more time and realized that wasn't necessarily the case. Still, all really well played, I'll give you that. Mostly, I'm so excited that these guys got to make this album and then did make this album. On the surface, it's awesome until it's not. Okay. So let's get into that. Track one, Eat Me Up Alive. Written by Carlos Cavazo, Stephen Piercy, and Warren DeMartini.
Holy shit!
Holy shit, that's awesome. 5 stars. As with every other Rat album review I've done here, somehow they've all made me say at some point, this is one of my all-time favorite Rat songs ever. And it's absolutely true again. Top five for sure, but more like top three. If I'm making my own Rat best of album and I can only have 10 tracks, and that has to go as my pick for the 10 best Rat songs of all time, and I have to make a video about that for you guys too, which I've decided I'm absolutely going to do as soon as I'm done with the final album ranking video I do after this video. This has got to be the opening track. No doubt. I think this is the best opening track on any Rat album ever. This is also the heaviest thing on any Rat album ever, as far as I'm concerned. And I absolutely love every second of it. Warren and Carlos splitting the solo here. And gosh, doesn't it just sound sweet? A trade-off solo in a Rat song. That's a sound we haven't heard in 25 years at the point when this album comes out, people. I really love this music video too. In a March 18, 2010 interview with Metalholic magazine, guitarist Warren DeMartini said of Infestation, "It really exceeded our expectations. Conceptually, we kind of wanted to revisit the period of Out of the Cellar and Invasion of Your Privacy. We were sort of loosely trying to shoot for something that could fit between those two records. We were looking for more up-tempo ideas and the double leads that Robin Crosby and I started doing back in 1983." So obviously they were aware of that being one of the things some of us most loved about the band when they first exploded onto the scene, just as we were. So why did it take so long to get back to that? I mean, I know Robin developed a drug problem that forever changed the course of Rat's career. But you couldn't have split a few solos on Invasion at least, or maybe even Dancing Undercover? Just a thought. I know it's not really anyone's fault. It just was. Track two, Best of Me. Written by Cavazo, Piercy, and Basquiat. Okay, and here's the big single from the album. And if you read the comments under the official YouTube video, apparently this might as well be the second coming of Round and Round. Greatest song ever, and all that. I don't know about all that. I give it 3 stars. It's okay. Again, 3 stars means okay. I really hate these kind of verses. Hate. I hate them.
What do you get when you got the best woman in this wild world?
If I have to explain that any further, maybe you should just be listening to some other kind of music, honestly. Like, I don't know. Nelson or Rick Astley or something. And watching review videos that are posted by people who are getting paid by the band. Clearly, I am not paid. You know, in case you couldn't tell from the special effects I use in these videos. And what's up with this video? Don't get me wrong, I absolutely love the performance stuff, and I do get what the song is about, but now I really have to sit here and watch these guys hug on their girlfriends for 4 minutes. I've waited 20 years for a new rap video to watch that. And now everything that got me so excited about Eat Me Up Alive has been sufficiently tempered. Jesus, I may need a nap before I get to track three. No, I'm going to push on for you guys. I hope you appreciate my sacrifice. Track three, A Little Too Much. Written by Basquiat, Piercy, and Demartini. 4 stars. I'm going to give away a little secret at this point in the review. When I did the initial ratings for the songs on this album a few days ago, 2 songs got 5 stars. 1 song got 4 stars. Everything else on the album got 3 stars. Now, I listened to the album again right before putting this review together, and that did change, thankfully. I really don't want this review to come off in a negative way. I really am glad we have this album in the rap catalog, truly. But I wanted you to know, I really had to work at this. If you still think, as I did in 2010, that this album is flawless and incredible and great, what can I say? My view has just changed over time. It happens. I'm sorry, rap fans, but I just can't do these reviews just to blow smoke and say nothing but, oh, this is great. Oh, this is great. Oh, this is great. I'm a big fan of everything. I'm not a big fan of everything. Ask Kiss fans. They'll tell you what I talked about in those reviews. I want to be a fan of this, but sometimes it just doesn't go the way you want it to. Yes, so this song was going to be a 3-star song originally, but when I listened again, at a lower volume probably, it sounded a little better. I like the riffs. I like the lead guitar. I love the verses. I dig the pre-choruses, and the chorus isn't completely terrible, though I'm not thrilled with it. So, yeah, 4 stars. Track four, Look Out Below. Written by Bobby Blotzer, Stephen Piercy, and Basquiat. And now we're back to 3 stars again. I mean, it's cool. It is. I almost managed 4 stars, though I didn't. Stephen Piercy said in a February 17, 2010 interview with the Artisan News Service, "We wanted this to be like something we would have written right after Out of the Cellar. We definitely went back to basics with the mindset of a band with a lot of excitement and some great songs to get out." And I think that's great. But we're already through the first four tracks on the album, and I've only heard one of those songs. Are the rest coming soon? Because I'm only going to live a certain number of years, as far as I know, and I have other things I could be. I do like this song, but I've also heard it in between the truly great tracks on pretty much every other album these guys have done. Even though it had different names on those albums, it got 3 stars those other times too. Track 5, Last Call. Written by DeMartini, Cavazzo, Piercy, and Basca. Okay, here is another great song. 5 stars. Yes! This sounds like a Rat song to me. What a freaking chorus! This would have been great on any album in the catalog. There should have been a video for this tune. Track 6, Lost Weekend. Are you ready for big fun? Written by Robbie Crane, Stephen Piercy, and Basket. 4 stars. Pretty cool tune here. I like it. I bet I would have liked it even more if I was 30 years younger. At this point, I have to actually think about shit like that when I do these reviews, I guess. Because I'm not 30 years younger, it seems like all I really think about when I hear songs like this one, or Paul and Gene singing about what they're doing with some chick in the hotel elevator or whatever, while they are pretending they aren't really in their 60s when Monster comes out, is that these guys aren't 30 years younger anymore either. And it would probably be okay if they wanted to realize that right along with me. That's twice now I've drawn a comparison between Infestation and Monster. That's even bothering me. But, I mean, perhaps it's also fairly apt. Track 7, As Good As It Gets. Written by Piercy, Basquet, and Cavazzo. Okay, and speaking of absolutely ridiculous songs, this one barely got 2 stars. I mean that. This is seriously not good. That's only my opinion, of course. But it most certainly is. And every time I hear that line about grinning like a Cheshire cat, I just stop and briefly question what I'm doing with my life. I realize not everyone will agree, and as always, that's absolutely fine. But I think this is fucking terrible. Track 8, Garden of Eden. written by DeMartini and Piercy. All right, a song written by just Warren and Steven. I've been waiting for this. The only song on the album besides Eat Me Up Alive, not co-written by the producer. Interesting. But let's see. What's the definition of filler again? And yeah, that equals 3 stars tops. Track 9, Take a Big Bite.
What do you get when you got nothing to lose? You got an empty hat with your alligator shoes. You walk the thinnest line, you make me lose your mind. You make my heart see shivers up and down my spine.
Written by DeMartini, Piercy, and Basquiat. Okay, that's a little closer. Not a lot, but a little. 4 stars. Track 10, Take Me Home. Written by Piercy, DeMartini, and Basquiat again. I guess this could be considered the ballad. I like it. I don't love it like I did Giving Yourself Away by any stretch, but I do like it. Oddly, again, the chorus seems to be the weakest part of the song. Still gave it 4 stars. And the final track, track 11, Don't Let Go. Written by Blotzer, Piercy, John Karabi, and Basquiat. 4 stars. There we go. That's the stuff. I wanted to go 5 stars, but couldn't quite get over that hump. But I do really like it. And yeah, John Karabi was actually in Rat for a little while. A pretty little while. But it's nice to see he at least got a songwriting credit out of the deal since he didn't stay in it very long. You know, the whole revolving door of members. Okay, so that's a total of 41 stars for the tracks divided by 11 tracks, which equals 3.73 total stars if I round up, which I do. Now, having said all that, what's the bottom line? First, I do not hate this album. I don't even dislike it. I like it, in fact, quite a bit. And all right, clearly, in my opinion, some of the songs aren't as great as I was hoping they would be. But some of them are. And believe me, Rat fans, I wake up every day wanting to love this album. I want it to be a perfect album and rival Out of the Cellar and live up to every expectation I could possibly have for it. And okay, it just didn't. For about a week or three, I thought maybe it did. But over time, most of these songs just don't quite hold up as well as I need them to. But before you start throwing shit at me, clearly this is a great comeback album for Rat. And clearly there are other bands who put out albums that have been far worse than Infestation ever thought about being. And I'm fully ready to acknowledge that fact. As much as I love them, Kiss has multiple albums that aren't this good. Motley Crue had an album right smack in the middle of their prime that wasn't this good. A few bands most people seem to love have entire catalogs that aren't this good. The problem, honestly, is that this album sounds so fucking distorted that I'm reluctant to listen to it. Now, if you don't happen to have noticed the distorted sound I hear being an issue for you, if you think I'm just too picky about sound quality sometimes and you can't imagine how I can complain about this when I clearly love Black Sabbath's Born Again and Kiss's Hotter Than Hell and Rat's EP and a few other things, hey, I totally get that. And God bless, that makes me happy for you. Because as I've said before, that gives you another album to love, and I wish I could say the same. Take this CD and listen to it until the silver rubs off. From what I gather in 2022, Bobby Blotzer still loves Infestation, even though Warren and Steven apparently do not share that feeling anymore. Okay, so how did everything go after this album came out? You people already know the answer to that. If you don't know, well,
sunshine almost always makes me high. If I had a day that I could give you, give to you a day just like today.
Basically, the guys played a bunch of shows together from time to time. Everyone was out of the band at some point, then back in the band, then back out of the band. And they have basically all sued each other over stupid shit as many times as they could probably afford. Meanwhile, they never recorded another album. And at this point, almost certainly never will. Oh, yes. And eventually, lead singer Stephen Piercy was taking bassist Juan Cruchier, who finally came back to what was left of the band, and a bunch of other guys around to state fairs and shit to play concerts for people eating their corn dogs and funnel cakes. And Warren DeMartini, who Rat stated would no longer be involved with the current touring lineup because he didn't want to go out there anymore, is playing similar, but probably at least slightly more interesting, shows with the Kings of Chaos, which he joined after being forced out of Rat because he didn't want to play anymore. Right. As for Bobby Blotzer, apparently, over the last year or two, Blotz and Piercy have at least sort of started trying to rekindle their friendship. And Piercy has been saying he wants to get the original band back together again. Or at least he was saying that. Now he's not. I certainly think everyone wants to see that happen. Though at this point, I truly believe it would be no less than miraculous. Which really sucks. Because these guys aren't going to live forever. And now they're just being stupid about it. Meanwhile, Had they been able to just grow the fuck up and put that shit behind them, I truly believe they could have and should have been a part of this stadium tour with Motley Crue and Def Leppard. And then I would have bought a ticket. Okay, so that's the Rat Albums, ladies and gents. And now, even though I believe I said in one of the last videos that I would probably include the final Rat album rankings in this video to wrap up the Rat topic, I have decided against that because I do not want a bunch of jump to the last page of the book first people to see the video titled Rat Album Ranking and have to sit through me complaining about an album for however many minutes this is now before I even get to that ranking. And then they wind up just coming away from that whole experience thinking I think Rat sucks or something, which could not be further from the truth. In case some of you couldn't tell, Rat is absolutely one of my favorite bands in the history of the world, and always will be. And if you can't tell that from the content of this video, then I would recommend you go back to the reviews I recently did for the EP and Out of the Cellar and most of these other albums and judge based on a more complete picture, please. Anyway, I will be back in short order with that final ranking video for the Rat catalog. And hopefully my ears won't be hurting from listening to someone try to make one of my favorite bands of all time sound like a bunch of 90s and 2000 bands I couldn't possibly care less about. Which is a little like picking up one of your favorite books on a rainy day, only to find someone has replaced the pages with the latest issue of fucking Rolling Stone magazine when you weren't looking. I thank you for understanding. Now, before I end here, I just want to offer you a sort of sneak peek into the next video that's coming. Rat, the final album ranking video here on Hard Rock Reverie. That video is going to be the first part of really wrapping things up as far as Rat is concerned for now. And it will also include links to some very relevant audio and video footage of the band, including the most recent Eddie Trunk interview with Stephen Piercy, a Mitch Lafon interview with Bobby Blotzer, and links to the Stephen Piercy rockumentary, which follows Stephen around the San Diego and LA areas as he reminisces about his formative years and Rat's early days, and gives a tour of Rat Mansion West, and even their first rehearsal room in his parents' former home in San Diego, where he really got his start in music. All right, take it easy, Rat and Rollers, and I will see you next time for that. Out. Let's go. Maybe wrong, but it feels so right.